and then determining what the proper size of a contract should be. So in order to have a large bundled contract, the agencies would have to justify that in some way to show that there still will be enough competition for the contract. There are a number of additional steps beyond that. We see that as one of the most important steps. But basically speaking, what they need to do is show that the benefit from bundling contracts in terms of reduced cost to the government, reduced administrative burden in issuing a smaller number of contracts, outweighs the potential harm in terms of diminishing the number of businesses that are competing for that contract, including small businesses.
Is it the view of the SBA Office of Advocacy that the change in federal policy has in fact been beneficial both to the federal government in getting competition and best price for contracting, as well as beneficial to small business?
Yes, it is our view that the program has been largely beneficial. What we've seen is, and there was a lot of interest, obviously, in contract bundling in the federal government. Reports from the GSA itself, which is the primary non-defense government contracting agency, and the General Accountability Office, showed that some of the savings in contract bundling, when you consider the entire set of factors that should be considered in contracts, were not as great as were shown up front when the contract bundling push started in the early 90s. So what we saw was, you know, there were immediate savings up front in terms of reduced cost in the number of contracts and some of the prices. But as the supplier base dwindled and people were driven out of competing for contracts, we saw, increases in prices that reduced some of the original cost savings, in large part because there were no longer small business competitors that were able to compete for the contracts, largely because they didn't have the capacity to produce the goods and services that are specified in the contract. So we have seen a benefit. There still are a number of bundling type programs in the federal government. There's the government-wide acquisition contracts, which allow multiple agencies to purchase from a single supplier under a single contract. There are indefinite delivery, indefinite quantity contracts that allow the government to change the terms of the contract after sign because they're not specified up front, which means that you need to have a very large capacity to be able to handle potential increases in what's required. And there are other multiple award contract vehicles in the federal government. Some of them remain concerned to my office and to people working on this and to small businesses, frankly. However, we have definitely seen a reduction in the number of certainly the traditionally bundled contracts, the way that bundling is usually described, and the reduction in the number of small business contractors was somewhat reversed from what I had mentioned that happened in the 1990s.
And so what you were just referring to is that over time the economic advantage that was identified at the outset of bundling dissipated, and that in fact competition was reduced and prices tended to rise. So it was critical to have kept measuring over time what was occurring in the contracting marketplace.
Correct. And primarily, again, that is because the contracts become so large that there are very few companies that are able to compete for the contracts. And in many cases, it came down to just one or two potential bidders for the contract because no one else lacked, no one else had the capacity for production that was specified in the size of the contract.
What time frame are you referencing?
The general studies that were done and at the time at which the sort of unbundling move happened was in 2002 under the president's initiative at the time. The time frame was 1991 through 2001. That was the sort of beginning of the bundling.
Window.
So it was a 10 or 11 fiscal year window, yeah, that we really looked closely at the issues. After that, again, like I said, the unbundling initiative happened. Since then, we've only done a number of updates, and they've looked at things like size of the supplier base, which, by the way, is something that the Department of Defense and the GSA, the largest procuring agencies, often look at anyway. They like to update that themselves and have a catalog of government suppliers in various industries. But we've noticed a reversal. The 56% reduction in small business contractors that happened has reversed, and we're at a higher level now.
Does the federal government have small business requirements like the state of California does as it relates to contracts, or for disabled vets?
The federal government has strategic goals for small business contracting. There is an office in the Small Business Administration. It's not my office, but a small business contracting office that's responsible for helping to enforce those goals throughout the federal government at the various agencies. I believe the goal is 23% at the federal government, but don't quote me on that because it's not not an area that I deal with all the time.
Anything for disabled vets?
There is a sub-goal for disabled vets. There's also a program that allows specific set-asides for veteran-owned businesses or service-disabled veteran-owned businesses, as well as other types of disadvantaged businesses, minority-owned businesses, a number of categorizations that the SBA oversees in large part, but there are offices throughout the federal government and procuring agencies that that have their own operations to.
And have you seen a reduction in the number of those type of businesses that we've just identified applying for or being utilized in contracts?
Not since not over the last 10 years since the reduction. There was a general reduction at the time when contract bundling was being pushed. It affected small businesses and all of the small businesses mentioned. From a statistical point of view, generally speaking, the small businesses that we usually look at and call disadvantaged small businesses or the other small businesses such as veteran-owned small businesses and minority-owned small businesses are often smaller than, you know, the quote-unquote average small business. So they tend to be even slightly smaller businesses, and therefore, in some sense, one would think they were even more disadvantaged by the contract bundling program than the typical or average small business was.
But you just said that in the past 10 years you haven't seen a reduction in the number.
In the past 10 years we haven't, and again, that's because of the turnaround and the fact that we've actually the federal government went into, you know, what could broadly be called an unbundling mode, and small business set-asides and small business contract goals have largely been met by most of the procuring agencies in the federal government. They've done a relatively good job of keeping on top of that, and the ones that do set-asides specifically for veteran-owned businesses or service-disabled veteran-owned businesses have done rather well. We would still like to see the numbers higher, as would the veteran-owned business community and the small business community in general, but they're making progress and certainly doing a better job than in the past.
Okay. Did you have a question, Mr. Chairman?
I'd just love to have a copy of your remarks, because it's really clear that, you know, we don't want to have a situation where the government where we want to enhance competition actually has policies that creates monopolistic practices and over time stifles it's in our binder, I see. Okay. Stifles competition. So I'd be really interested and I know we've got an outline here on tab 7. I didn't see this here, but in terms of exactly what changes you made, because clearly your charts are compelling in terms of the results from the actions that you took, and I think we ought to be looking towards doing some of the same.
Okay, thank you for being here, Mr. Johnson. Very helpful. Oh, I'm sorry. Before you leave, Mr. Johnson, Ms. Grove.
Hi, thank you for being here, and I'm sorry I had to step out. You know, there were some small business owners that came up to testify, and one of them made a statement that the parameters of a small business is it should be $10 million or less in gross receipts or revenues, and DGS has changed that or given a parameter for a contract to be $75 million. Is the federal going to change theirs, or what's your outline for the definition of a small business when it equates to revenues?
The Office of Size Standards in the Small Business Administration, which again is not my office, is responsible under federal law for setting small business size standards. They do that through informal rulemaking, notice and comment. So they post their research and background for setting a size standard in the Federal Register and ask people in the affected small business community, others to comment on that and provide information as to whether or not they're correct. My office has input on that, and we interact with small businesses, but we don't make the determinations. Currently, there are a large number of small business size standards. There's not a single size standard. So if you look at the federal level, if you look at the small business industry sectors as defined by the North American Industry Classification System, which is the requirement under the law. There's basically a small business size standard for every narrowly defined industry sector. Some of them are based on revenue, as you mentioned. Some of them are based on another capacity measure. Some of them are based on the number of employees in the business.
The way I understood it, though, when they were talking is that in order to qualify as a small business, you had to have $10 million or less in revenue, and then in order to qualify for the DGS contract, you had to have $75 million in revenue. So I'm wondering, it's often, as a business owner, we find ourselves that the government really doesn't know what the right hand and the left hand are doing. And so when you're told one thing and then you have to comply with another and it's a government agency. So my question, I guess, is like, going from 10 million to 75 million without losing the qualification of a small business under the federal standards, is there a way to communicate with state agencies to make sure that doesn't happen?
Correct. Well, I mean, at the federal level, as I said, the Office of Size Standards and the Small Business Administration sets the small business size standard, and it is for federal contracting purposes. And under that law, the federal procuring agencies are required to use that size standard, so they can't change a size standard definition. The problem that we ran into in contract bundling was generally the same problem, wherein it wasn't defined within the contract specifically in terms of you have to be able to do $75 million of business, but the parameters that were set up were such to basically create the same situation where the size of the contract, the scope of the contract was too large for a business that had that could qualify as a small business under the law.
I think your department recently did a study for small business, and I appreciate everything that you do for the small business in not only California but the nation. You recently did a study that it costs small businesses 364% more to comply with environmental and regulatory issues and 206% more to comply with tax issues. And it's an overall burden to small business at $2,830 per employee. Can you comment on that research? I know this hearing isn't about that, but I was just curious about your response.
Generally,
a very brief comment because that's not the subject of the
hearing. And I agree, it's not the subject, but I've got you right here in front of me, so I was just curious about that huge astronomical expense that you have determined it costs business to operate in the state.
Right. Generally speaking, it's simply saying that for small businesses, if you look at a per unit of input or per unit of output measure, it costs them more per unit of input or output to comply with federal regulations than a small business. Generally, it's measuring the economies of scale effect of a larger business. And it's really an argument that my office actually enforces an act in the federal government that asks agencies when they're writing regulations to take small businesses into consideration. And generally speaking, it's designed to ask agencies to make sure that the costs are commensurate with the size and scale of the business.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson, again, for being here this morning. Appreciate your testimony very much. And now we're going to take a look a little further into this with Samuel Bornstein, a professor of accounting and taxation from Keene University School of Business. And good morning, and also thank you to you for making the trip from the East Coast to join us.
It was a pleasure.
You've got a short PowerPoint, as I understand it, and Ms. Buchanan, you may want to just shift over a seat or two so that you don't star in the PowerPoint.
Seconds, we should be ready. Good. And if we maybe just lower that microphone a little bit. It's just a little. Sorry for the delay. We should be okay now. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
How's that? Good. Thank you. Okay.
Good morning, Chair and Vice Chair and members of the committee. Thank you for inviting me to share my research on the impact of strategic sourcing on California's small and disabled veteran businesses. In this presentation, I'll refer to them as small business. My name is Samuel Bornstein. For the past 33 years, I've been a professor of accounting and taxation, as well as a CPA and consultant in public practice. This combination of experience as an educator and practitioner has given me an interesting perspective and insight into research on small business issues, which I've been conducting since year 2000 with my partner, Jung Song, CPA of Bornstein & Song CPAs and Consultants. On April 16, 2008, I was invited to present our research and testimony before the U.S. Senate Committee on Small Business and Entrepreneurship. Subsequently, I testified on this subject in many states. As a result of our research, we developed legislation which is currently sponsored in 5 states, Illinois, New Jersey, Missouri, Maryland, and New York. In California, it is being considered for legislation. Our Bornstein & Song research discovered that there was a link between California's strategic sourcing and small business jobs and the mortgage crisis. General Services stated that strategic sourcing accrued at least $160 million in net savings. The true savings to California comes with a price, the social service and other costs for displaced small businesses and lost jobs. In addition, based upon our Bornstein & Song research, there is another cost that we discovered which was unique to California and will have a greater negative impact on the California economy, the cost of small business owner defaults and foreclosures in the mortgage and housing crisis. We believe that due to these significant offsetting costs, the $160 million net savings was overstated and strategic sourcing will be detrimental to California. The savings from strategic sourcing give the impression that this cost-saving initiative is the panacea for federal, state, city, and municipal governments in this era of budget cuts through cost savings. But there are additional costs which the public sector must endure. The efficiencies gained through strategic sourcing must be offset by the resulting social service and other costs related to job loss from the shrinking number of small businesses and state contracts. These costs include state unemployment benefits, state tax revenue loss, economic loss in consumer spending and purchasing power, other state tax revenue losses from individuals and businesses, the loss of sales tax revenues, the social safety net costs, the social costs of worker displacement and retraining, and small business owner defaults and foreclosures' impact on the mortgage and housing crisis. Strategic sourcing displaces small businesses by reducing the number of small businesses that participate in state contracts. The state takes advantage of volume discounts, which lower prices and consolidate state expenditures into fewer contracts. This results in fewer contracting opportunities for small businesses and displaces many small businesses and their employees. California strategic sourcing shrunk 29,000 in small business contracts. This shows the potential displacement of small businesses and lost jobs. The auditor noted that there was data inaccuracies which detract from the usefulness of this information. Nevertheless, this graph is indicative of the drop in small business contracts. The loss of state contract revenues for the displaced small businesses has a multiplying effect on job loss. 90% of the state's small businesses employ from 1 to 19 workers. Based upon the net savings of $160 million, we estimated small business job loss at 3,255 jobs. We estimated the cost of job loss on the net savings of $160 million. The range of the cost of job loss is between $58 million to as much as $95 million. Therefore, our estimate of the true savings could be as low as $65 million, less the other costs which are unavailable at this time. Our conclusion is the $160 million net savings was overstated and strategic sourcing will be detrimental to California. According to our Bornstein & Song research, there is another cost that is unique to California which evolved from our study of the housing bubble. We noticed that during the housing bubble, small business owners refinanced their homes to extract cash for their businesses. As a result, we discovered a cost unique to California that has a great negative impact on the California economy, the cost of small business owner defaults and foreclosures in the mortgage and housing crisis. California strategic sourcing, which displaces small businesses, will have a negative impact on the significant number of California small business owners who refinanced their homes during the housing bubble years 2002 to 2007 as their home prices skyrocketed. The booming home values and weak or non-existent mortgage underwriting standards provided the perfect opportunity for California small businesses to cash out the equity in their homes to quench their continuous need for cash for their businesses with little or no proof of income. Our Barnes & Noble California Small Business Toxic Mortgage Surveys provides the first compelling evidence that a significant number of these small California small business owners were drawn into these toxic mortgages by the ease in which they could access cash for their businesses. With collapsing home values, credit crunch, and the recession, these small business owners will be at risk of losing their homes if their revenues decrease through strategic sourcing. The loss of state tax revenue, contract revenues, will place California small business owners at risk of default and foreclosure, as a significant number are currently burdened with high monthly mortgage payments. The resulting job loss will impact the small business community and contribute to California's spiking unemployment and housing crisis. I testified on the impact of toxic mortgages on California small business foreclosures and job loss before the California State Assembly Committee on Jobs, Economic Development, and the Economy on May 5, 2009 and October 19, 2009. Our survey provided an estimate of job loss. More than 1.5 million Californians were at immediate risk of job loss at April 2009, and more than 2.1 million California small business jobs will be lost in the second tsunami wave of foreclosures in 2009 to 2012. We were especially concerned that a significant number of California small business owners fell prey to the toxic mortgages, such as Alt-A, Alt-A ARMS, Option ARMS, Interest Only, and Subprime. These toxic mortgages originated in California, the mother of toxic mortgages. The California leads the nation with 58% of these toxic mortgages. California small business owners will be hardest hit as these mortgages reset and recast to unsustainably high monthly mortgage payments from 2009 to 2012. Our research concluded that this is a critical issue for the California economy. Our Bornstein & Song research discovered the link between California small business jobs and the mortgage crisis. We authored three Bornstein & Song small business toxic mortgage surveys, U.S. National, November 2008, California, April 2009, and California Hispanic, June 2009. We predicted the second tsunami wave of foreclosures and job loss. These surveys provide compelling evidence that a significant number of California small businesses, especially California Hispanic small businesses, fell prey to the toxic mortgages. Most shocking is that 51.8% of California and 52.6% of California Hispanic small business owners use toxic mortgages. California small business usage of toxic mortgages far exceeds the national average of 31.9%. These reset charts show the second tsunami wave of foreclosures. The credit rating agencies confirm the second tsunami wave has begun. In 2008, November 2008, we warned of the impending impact of toxic mortgages on small business failure, unemployment, and the drop in housing crisis. There is a correlation between the housing double dip and the second tsunami wave of foreclosures. California toxic mortgage characteristics, according to the Federal Reserve Bank of New York, 99.9% originated in 2004 to 2007 during the housing bubble. $426,000 was the average balance for cash out refinance. More than 50% will reset in 2010 to 2012. This confirms our research. In conclusion, strategic sourcing is toxic for small and disabled veteran businesses. California small businesses are at a high risk of failure. California leads the nation with the highest increase in small business failure rates of 149% from 2007 to 2010. We believe that our Bornstein & Song Small Business Toxic Mortgage Surveys predicted this outcome. Strategic sourcing shrinks the number of small businesses in state contracts and displaces many small businesses and their employees. Reducing small businesses at this time is a mistake. Small businesses are currently challenged to survive the headwinds of a sluggish consumer spending and the limited or non-existing access to capital. Small business needs this source of revenue for survival. California must overcome the current economic downturn before the state risks further job loss through strategic sourcing. We would be happy to share our recommendations for improving strategic sourcing for California. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. Looking forward to answering your questions.
Professor, thank you for that very rapid presentation of a lot of materials.
Tried to sneak it in.
You got it all in. But if I can try to distill just a couple points from it that seem to be particularly important. Your first is that considering the I'll use the holistic costs related to strategic sourcing is critical to understanding whether and to what extent money is actually saved by the state of California in this particular instance from using that approach to contracting.
Yes.
And your conclusion based on the analysis you've done is that the savings for the data that we have available, which the auditor said confirmed apparent savings of $160 million, you believe actually to be much, much smaller.
Dramatically smaller. We came up with some numbers, but very conservatively. We assumed based on $179 million of total savings. And we averaged it on the average, assuming that this was lost revenues for the small businesses, based on an average of $55,000 per employee, we came up with a very conservative estimate of $3,255. Even with that, we have the unemployment costs, we have the state tax losses, and from what we know, and then there's another interesting factor. There's 15% to 30% drop in replacement salaries. And even this research was done through 2000. We're in a totally different situation. Now with more people on the average being out of work, they'll probably settle for something less. So we have a law that's called the true cost, the true economic loss. And that's quantifiable, but it's dramatic. And so even with our numbers, we come up with a net savings of $65 million, and we haven't even considered all those other costs. So it's possible that we may be taking one step forward and maybe one and a half step back.
And then your second theme was about essentially the path that many small business owners went down by cashing in the equity on their personal residences or taking additional mortgages on as obligations in order to finance their businesses based upon an expectation which has not turned out to be fulfilled, that to the extent that contracting opportunities are lost because of strategic sourcing, that has exacerbated. I assume you don't attribute the great degree of difficulties of small business solely to that, but it's an exacerbating factor.
We found it very interesting. We did a national Bornstein and Song Small Business Toxic Mortgage Survey in November of 2008. And which followed up on my testimony in the U.S. Senate Small Business and Entrepreneurship Committee. We discovered, we wanted to quantify, we felt as CPAs, we are CPAs, I'm a professor, I'm also a CPA, work with my partner Jung Song, and we noticed in our own clientele that they were starting to cash in the equity in their homes. If you notice, there was a chart in the spike in home equity. And our clients were saying, hey, this is a unique opportunity. We don't even have to prove our income. They want to give us money. So go ahead, and we're going to invest it in our businesses. So as they invested into the businesses to cash out the equity of homes, we felt there's a problem because they are using these toxic mortgages. Count 5 years from 2004 to 2007, which is the booming years. They go 2009 to 2012. You'll notice in the reset chart there's going to be a spike and resets of these toxic mortgages, and New York Federal Reserve Bank confirmed our concern that 50% will be resetting shortly. We'll see a spike in these monthly mortgage payments will go up maybe 60 to 100 to 150, maybe 200%. That's going to be additional strain. California was unique. We had one that I presented to the California Assembly Committee on Jobs, Economic Development, and the Economy, and there we showed that more than 50% of California and over 53% of California Hispanic have these toxic mortgages. We're very concerned for California, because we see the numbers right now. Yesterday there was a report in the Wall Street Journal that 40% underwater, drop in home values. So with the drop in home values, we are very, very concerned for the state of California. Now if we add another issue that complicates and displaces small business, it'll make it and reduces their revenue. We have another headwind that these small businesses have to confront, not only to meet their monthly payment, which is going to spike, but now they have less revenue. And all the numbers with small business failure and all the other the areas that are concerned, housing prices, it all seems to fit. And that's why I had that that diagram for the correlation between the housing dip and our second tsunami wave of foreclosures. And so I felt this was an opportunity to exhibit that we have not only the concern of the social service costs, which are immense, we also have another cost which we feel is more unique and specific to California.
Thank you. Other questions? Yes, Ms. Grove.
Thank you for your testimony.
My pleasure.
On the first chart that you come up with, it's on page 5. Your PowerPoint isn't numbered, but I counted back page 5.
Sure.
In that graph, the auditor stated earlier, if you could pull that up, on page 5, the auditor, our state auditor, stated earlier that, mm-hmm. I'm going back to the graph.
Okay.
There it is.
Yeah.
That there were 29,000 contracts that were not a part of that graft.
I know.
Now, if you were to add in those 29,000 contracts, would that affect your entire presentation in any way, shape, or form?
Not at all.
Not at all.
This was a graph which I noticed. I also noted the qualifier that the auditor said that there was not really a $29,000 drop because of the data inaccuracies. This had nothing to do with my calculation. I just wanted, this was indicative of a possible drop in contracts. Our calculations were based upon the actual revenues that were saved, or the cost savings of $179 million, if you'll notice. They were not, let me see if I can get to that calculation. That had nothing, I just wanted to indicate the level of participation of each 90% of all small businesses employing 1 to 19. There's my calculation. The calculation had nothing to do with that estimate. It had to do with, so I'll point to you here. I have a little thing here. You'll notice that the total strategic savings per the auditor was $179,000, which we viewed as lost revenues for small businesses. The net was $160,000 after the subtractions of the commission and the fees for the KPMG. And so if we divide that by the $55,000, which is the average job salary, we come up with a $3,255, which I then use in my next calculations right over here for the unemployment benefits. The range from average to maximum, my state tax loss revenue, this is from the state franchise tax board, $3,600 per employee lost jobs, and then my economic loss. So you'll see that that $29,000 really had no impact.
Can you go back to the previous slide that you just
had? Sure.
Which is, it says small business job loss.
Yeah.
Where it says up on the top where it says total savings strategic sourcing per the auditor, $179
yes.
million.
Yes.
That number, are you assuming that there are no small business contracts in that savings? Because my understanding is that there, that just wasn't small business that was cut, or was it all small business?
Okay. I'm working with AIR for developing an estimate, because all we had was the 160 net savings.
Mm-hmm.
And so we figured we have to come up with some number, which is an estimate, and we believe it's a conservative estimate. And so we assume, let's say, even if it's small business or other businesses, if we have $179 million of lost revenues, they will equate to lost jobs, we feel. And to determine how many lost jobs, using the average of 55,000, which is documented in our footnotes, we estimated on the low side 3,255 jobs lost.
Is the number they're using there, is it lost revenues for, say, they had to, I don't know, lay off state employees because they didn't need so many to do contracts now that they were bundling?
Well,
is that equated in that, or is that just private industry?
Actually, I believe this is the contracts on strategic sourcing, I believe, were with private industry.
Okay.
And since we assumed, since private industry lost $179 million of revenues, we wanted to come up with a number that we can maybe arrive at that would be very, this is a conservative guess, 3255. We've seen number, anecdotally, in my written testimony, mm-hmm. There's an interesting statement by a business, and he's actually a veteran, commenting on the Federal Reserve, federal program similar to this. and where he lost 67% of his employees, and he's dramatic loss of revenues. So based on the assumption that, assumed maybe that we have $179 million of lost revenues, how do we equate that to lost jobs?
I mean, your information is very interesting. I find it interesting. I wish the legislature would take action to make sure that when they pass, you know, ridiculous workers' comp or regulatory reforms or things like that or regulatory expansions, that they would use your analysis on how it affects business and foreclosures and all the way down the line and it affects stuff. It's an interesting concept.
As a CPA, we deal with the IRS a lot. And the IRS has manuals to estimate underreported income, under revenue, of course. So, for an example, in a barbershop, how do they identify how much lost revenue they estimate? They count the number of barbers that are working there and multiply by salary. For, let's say, a laundromat, how do you estimate how much laundromat was unreported? Well, they count how much water has been used. Okay? And so, the same token, we're working backwards, working with $160 million of net. Getting to a gross of 179, these are numbers from the auditor's report. Hmm. Let's come up with a number. And then what's most fascinating is this chart here. We see the, just to give you an idea of the social service costs, of course, there are unemployment. There's the tax revenue loss. There's this economic loss, which is an extremely critical factor. Someone who had a $55,000 salary on a low side may settle with an $8,200 job if that person finds a job, may settle for a $46,000 salary. But a $55,000 may settle for a $38,000. I've heard anecdotally they'll settle for half that. So we have lost purchasing power. And this is one of the critical issues. As we serve today, if there's lack of consumer spending, small businesses don't make revenue, we have a continuous cycle. Let me throw in another part. We have a self-perpetuating cycle. If we have a small business that suffers, the employee that loses the job, the employee cannot pay the mortgage, is forced to be foreclosed upon, and the small business owner has financial distress, we have an ever-ending cycle, and that's not what we need. We don't need more foreclosed homes. And the report was that the housing drop, this is now a double dip.
Exactly. And your testimony here with all this, I find it very fascinating because it's just not the bundling of services that causes all of this to happen.
No, there's more to it. And California particularly is more at risk than other states. And that's why we took the trip from New Jersey, because California is the mother of toxic mortgages. And it was interesting, when we testified in the U.S. Senate on April 16, 2008, we made that theory that we believed that a significant number of small business owners would be caught at accessing the built-up equity in their homes. Let me see if I can find this. There we go. You see, this is the home refinancing equity extraction. You'll notice from 2002 all of a sudden it spikes to 2007. But in this period of time when we had a housing bubble, here's the housing bubble for California. There are three. I picked three cities. I can't read it accurately, but I see here it's Sacramento, Los Angeles, Riverside, San Bernardino, and San Diego. Look at that bubble. There's an interesting picture of the bubble. And that bubble, this area here is equity that has been built up in people's homes. Significantly, small business owners got this without having to prove their income. And we wanted to prove it. We proved that on a national basis, and my first step after I proved that on a national basis, I immediately called California. And I saw that, hey, we're going to have a problem here nationally, and I got the attention of the Department of Labor. They set up a think tank, and we developed, and we were actually going through an understanding that the director of the think tank said he was shocked with these numbers. And that was before I conducted the California Small Business Toxic Mortgage Survey, which was worse. And as a result of our California Small Business Toxic Mortgage Survey, I was invited to testify on May 5th, 2009, to the California Assembly Committee on Jobs, Economic Development, and the Economy. And that's where I presented this. As a matter of fact, Assemblyman Block was at that hearing.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you, sir, very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Oh, did you have one? Okay.
I appreciate your work. I just question some of your conclusions, because whether a small business does business with the government or not, if a small business owner took out a toxic mortgage and you put that money in the business and now their home mortgage is at risk, to link that with procurement seems to me to be a stretch. I mean, that's certainly, I think, a bigger problem that we're dealing with. Yeah. I mean, my interest is in making sure that we support small businesses, that we compete on a level playing field, that we're transparent, and that we, as the federal representative talked about, have a climate that's vibrant, so that the new industries that are created and all of that can, yeah, through small businesses can flourish. And even with your $179 million, which I appreciate, depends on what you did with that money. If you went out and did other procurement or gave money to other small businesses, you're still creating jobs. If we spent more money in education, you have more teachers in the classroom. So I appreciate the work you're doing. I'm just not sure that all those conclusions can be drawn. I think some of it is a stretch, but I think the underlying point that there's a trickle-down effect that's a positive to our economy from supporting small businesses is an excellent one. But yeah. I just wanted to make that.
I respect comment. That. I respect that. The $179 million, again, we were thinking of how do we come up with a number. If we have clearly the strategic sourcing is a cost-saving option. It's a volume discount. If we go to a vendor and we displace, in case of a federal program, they displaced, it was called the 75 program. They originally had 500 businesses in that group of office supplies. They consolidated into 75. So we viewed that maybe that 179 million could be viewed the same way as 425 businesses may have lost revenues.
It's one way of saying this is what it's equivalent to, but drawing the conclusion that this is what happened depends on what you did with $179 million.
Well,
I just need to point that out.
I appreciate it.
And the same thing with the toxic mortgage, because the procurement policies in no way created the mortgage bubble in the state of California. Now, the fact that we had the mortgage bubble and some people, whether they were small business people, whether they were employees in large businesses, government employees, whatever, may have taken mortgages that they shouldn't have taken, you know, and banks shouldn't have loaned them to begin with. I actually blame the lending institutions more than I do the individuals.
I don't think the professor's point was it exacerbated the
situation. But that was my point. I don't want people who are watching this, to draw that conclusion, because I do think that certainly the subprime mortgage has had a major impact on individuals, whether they're took that mortgage and put it in their back into their home into improvement, to put it into their business, the equity they've lost. I mean, it's had a profound effect. Yeah. But I just wanted to make that it clear, because I do think that's a tough.
Yeah, it wasn't. It's all cause and effect.
I know, but when you put the numbers and talk about Congress and all of that,
I will mention that it's our three surveys that confirm, and I had the chart with the three survey comparison, that it's interesting. And I've spoken to economists, and we're gratified, very happy to hear that they agree with us that this is the first time they've ever viewed it that way, that this impacts small business.
Of course.
We noticed that from our client and anecdotally throughout the country, and that's why we have five states, happily, that have legislation based upon our proposals, which we're very gratified to see and more interested in gaining momentum, that small business is involved in this mortgage crisis. And it's not because they wanted to get an easy ride, it's because they're always looking for an easy access to cash.
Sure.
And these all-day option arms was the easiest way, and it was available. They went for it. Now, do I blame them? I don't blame them that this was available.
I'm just saying, if you would have asked me what states did it affect small businesses more, I would have given you the same states that it affected the economies more, that have the higher unemployment rate. So,
yeah.
So I certainly there's an impact there, but I just want to be sure we're not drawing
conclusion.
Professor, we need to close it out.
We have
one more set of witnesses to hear from. So, again, very much appreciate your work and your presentation, your presence here. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it. I'll turn this over.
Now we will have the Department of General Services, and we have Jim Butler, the State Chief Procurement Officer, Greg Sandin, the Statewide Travel and
Meeting Management Program Chief, and Gary Link, the Deputy Director of Legislative Affairs. Good morning. Although we're running out of morning rapidly, so I know we've gotten to you late, but brevity is going to be a real virtue here. Thank you.
Good morning, members. I'm Gary Link, Deputy Director of Legislation. And in the interest of brevity, I'm going to bypass my intro and introduce Jim Butler, our Chief Procurement Officer, and Greg Sandin, our Chief of the Statewide Travel Management. They're here to answer any questions and address any issues you guys have to them.
I would, again, Jim Butler at the Department of General Services, like to thank the committee for the opportunity to come speak to you today. I also would like to recognize the contributions of witnesses, Mr. Bertrand Simpson, who sit on the DGS Statewide Small Business Advisory Council, been very helpful to us, as well as the Bureau of State Audits, again, for their contributions to our understanding of this issue and to the many improvements that we believe we've been able to make. We are often asked about the balance between cost savings and economic development as it applies to small business and DVB contracting in the state. While we believe that achieving that balance is an ongoing effort, we'll never be finished with it. We do believe that the current policy is reasoned, it's lawful, and it's a transparent approach that strikes a balance between these sometimes conflicting interests. And we have developed that policy through the kind of cooperation I just talked about with members of the small business community, the legislature, the other government oversight groups, as well as the advocacy groups and DVB firms themselves. So when you look at these competing interests, there's a couple of facts I would like to just point out. Number one, DGS administers what we call mandatory contracts. The term strategic sourcing has been used quite a bit here today. Strategic sourcing is just one way of doing procurements. It was introduced between 4 and 5 years ago. As one of the witnesses mentioned, however, the state has been doing statewide mandatory contracts for probably more than 20 years now. And it really is the mandatory nature of those contracts that I think gives rise to the concerns, because those by designating these contracts as mandatory, departments are obligated to use them, sometimes at the expense of small businesses and DVBEs. So what have we done to mitigate those concerns? First of all, these contracts are a very tiny portion of the overall statewide spend. In your binder, if you go to the very first exhibit, there's a copy of the chart that we've also placed upon the easel behind you that shows total contracting for the state in the blue bars over the period of 2005 through 2009. It also shows in the green the total contracting with small businesses and DVBEs. And in the purple section, you'll see the amount of contracting that was actually done on all of these statewide mandatory contracts. So what do the numbers mean? In the most recent year, we have reporting SBDVB contracting represented over $2.4 billion in contracting, or roughly three times greater than the $726 million for all mandatory contracts. Those mandatory contracts also represented less than 9% of the total contracting in the state for that same period. Over the last 4 years, spending with SB small business and DVBEs has exceeded spending on mandatory contracts by 435%, $9.4 billion versus $2.2 billion. Also, small businesses can and do win these mandatory contracts as prime vendors. They also nearly always participate in our mandatory contracts as subcontractors, as was mentioned by the state auditor. Many categories of spend in the state are also dominated by small businesses. Food contracting generally is over 70% of all contracts are held by small businesses. And in some categories, like office products, it's nearly 100%. We have a policy that has gotten us to a point that we think is within balance. That policy includes things like awarding contracts under $250,000 to SB DVBEs first. That's the first place we look for any contract under $250,000. After that, we ensure that small businesses are not prevented from selling on any statewide contracts to what we call off-ramps. So if, even if we have a mandatory contract, we also allow any state agency to go buy from a competing small business or DVB for up to $250,000 through the off-ramp. And then we also include preferences when we award those contracts initially for prime contractors to use small businesses and DVBs. Those preferences are allowed in law and have resulted in a very high participation of small businesses and DVBs in our mandatory contracts. I'd like to talk shortly about unbundling. The state has gone to great efforts to unbundle these mandatory contracts. Well over 85% of our statewide mandatory contracts are unbundled. That number is even higher in the food category, over 90%. And that is not just the number of contracts, but the dollars that I'm specifically talking about.
Can I clarify, what was that number? I apologize, I didn't catch it.
For unbundling is over 85%, yes, on our statewide contracts. We also conduct, whenever we go to award a new mandatory contract, we conduct what we call small business DVB matchmaking events. So the small businesses that would like to become subcontractors can meet the potential prime contractors, actually sit down with them, talk to them about why the prime contractors should use them as a small business. The department conducts in excess of 150 outreach events a year across the state, every location that we can get to. Sometimes that is limited by travel cost reductions, but we have a very aggressive outreach program. And I'll point you to Exhibit 2 and ask my trustee assistant if he can move the chart. We also have another chart that shows the level of small business and DVB certification. So thank you, Ms. Buchanan. That's extra charges, I'm sure, to get your help with that.
That's why I went to college.
Okay. This is a chart that shows the level of certifications for small businesses and DVBEs. So over time, not only has the number of contracts awarded increased, as the auditor testified earlier today, not only have the dollars awarded to small businesses and DVBs increased, but the total number of certifications also has increased. And while we're gratified to see that number increase, it's actually very small in comparison to the total number of small businesses in the state. Estimates range between 1.5 and 2.5 million small businesses in the state, and currently there are less than 25,000 certified businesses. So even though we have a lot of them, the state's share of that is very small, and as a result, trying to, you know, divine any trend overall from the state sample is very difficult to do. I'll just finish by saying,
clarifying.
Yes.
When you're saying these are the numbers participating, they're the ones that have been certified, or that's the number that have been awarded contracts?
Certified.
Okay.
I'll finish by saying that in Exhibit 3 and Exhibit 4, we've included some lists of recognition that the department has received over the last several years for its work in this area. The department has been recognized more than 25 times for its outstanding contributions to this work. I have a tremendous staff who are very dedicated, who have the small business and DVB interests baked to the core in everything that they do. And you'll see that as you look through not only the list of awards for the department, but the many, many emails of recognition that we've received for those people. And with that, I'll go ahead and turn the time over to Mr. Sandin.
Thank you, Mr. Chair and members, for inviting us today. We appreciate it. We at the Statewide Travel Program are very, very excited about what we're going to be doing. We're the envy of most of the nation right now. In fact, a lot of corporations who are looking at us to set an example on how we establish centralized billing and centralized travel. We like to tell people when we do our training throughout the state, we ask, the very first question we ask is, how do you do your personal and leisure travel booking now? And 99% of those in the room raise their hand and say, we go online to do our booking. And that's exactly the culture change and behavior change we're trying to attempt with those in government, both in state government and city and county, K through 12 and community colleges, which are also a member of our statewide travel program. I'll be glad to answer any questions about some of the features of our program. One of the main themes I've heard here this morning is data. I'm glad to say that we've got an easy button now in our office where we're going to be able to push that button and provide real-time data on where you travel, how you travel, what mode of travel, the cost. We can also determine the ecological effect on your travel by what mode of transportation you take. So we've got many, many features in our travel store contract and have the ability to help those who are trying to get from point A to B in the state of California. I might add, out of the 250 or so state agencies that do travel, we have approximately 3/4 of those state agencies signed up using our travel store state agency, travel agency. In addition, we do the governor's travel, the state controller's office, the treasurer, and many of the constitutional offices in the state of California. So I will entertain any questions at this point concerning the travel contract.
Hey, thank you. I had a couple. Let's go back, sure, if we can, to your charts for a moment.
Yep.
The first chart that you had refers to the source contract spending, the small business DBBE spending, total contract awards. So this is, for example, looking at 8-9, this is $725+ million in source contracts. And correct, is that all done through the Department of General Services? And how do you collect that, or how have you accounted for that data?
Yes, that is the volume of contracts of the what we call statewide contracts that DGS had in place at that time. And we collect that information primarily through a billing system. We bill departments and agencies that use those contracts, a very small percentage for the use. That's how we're funded. We don't have any budget. And as a result, we have invoicing information about how often they were used.
Okay. And is it correct? There's no one in place like there was CGI to assess whether the prices that are getting paid are actually equal to, greater than, or less than what might be available if those contracts were unbundled.
We do collect price information on what we pay, and we do a conformance check on all the invoices to ensure that pricing is accurate to the contract. In terms of whether we save money or not, we have started tracking that. Earlier testimony indicated that DGS stopped tracking that, and that is accurate. About 3 years ago, after I came on board, we started tracking that again. Only within the last year has the tracking really been very reliable, and we have started to publish the information related to that. So we are now tracking the total spend on the contracts that we have in place.
So you're tracking the prices paid, but have you benchmarked it against what might be available in the marketplace if the contracts were unbundled?
Only at the time of procurement. So when we go conduct the bid, the best market data you can have are competitive offers. It's better than any market survey, right? You find out in real time what the going rate is for the items and services you want to buy.
But
and that's our benchmark.
If you've bundled it, how do you know what the price might be that would be bid if an element were unbundled?
Oh, well, then the other thing that we have is a feature of our off-ramps requires that in order to off-ramp, you have to be able to meet or beat the pricing of the contract. So we do find out very quickly whether or not our pricing is competitive. And on some contracts, we find that it's easy to off-ramp. And on other contracts, it's very difficult.
Okay. And we have heard criticism of the requirements on the off-ramp that mm-hmm. they become so complicated, complex, and costly to go through that it deters that from happening.
It used to be much easier. Prior to the current budget situation, there was no requirement for small businesses to meet or beat the contract pricing. But we kept hearing a couple of things. We kept hearing, number one, your contracts are not, you don't have good pricing anyway. And so we said, great, it shouldn't be hard for you to beat the pricing if it's so bad. And then number two is we just are in this environment where we're cutting back. We've had a hiring freeze in place for more than a year. As you know, the budgets are very, very difficult for the whole state. And from our perspective, the most prudent thing to do would be to ensure that we don't pay a higher price for an item than what we already have on a contract. And in some cases, let me give you the example of the office products contract. That contract was recently awarded to a certified California small business. So that small business made an offer of pricing, and they won the entire contract as a prime contractor. It's very difficult to then turn around and say, even though you made the commitment to do this kind of pricing, we're going to let your competitors come in and sell to us at a higher price.
So that you have that anecdote, do you have data for the entirety of your sourced contracting?
No, we do not have that data. We would only know the next time we go out to bid to be able to determine if better pricing is available.
Okay. Would you agree or disagree with the auditor's conclusion that there's a lack of data to determine the impact of strategic sourcing on the participation of small businesses and DVBEs?
I believe it depends on how you want to quantify impact. If the question is, what is the total spend with small businesses, I believe that we have the data that indicates to me that we're doing a very good job, because I have the data to show what our total spend is year in and year out to compare. If instead you want to compare, you know, how much did any specific small business win, and on average did they get more or less, we do not have that kind of data. So it really depends on how you want to define impact.
And I think that's the second half of it starts to get to the root of it, which is we're trying to assess whether in fact and under what circumstances if any contract bundling actually has a salutary effect for both the state and without even considering Professor Bornstein's analysis, which is several steps beyond the very first line of analysis, but also beneficial to small business. And so I don't want to put words in your mouth, but it sounds as if you would agree that the data you have available doesn't necessarily allow a complete analysis of that question.
Yeah, I would say that an economic impact study could be conducted if you wanted to understand that on an ongoing basis. I did note the metrics that the witness from the federal government offered, though, and he was talking again about total amount of spend, how much of that is going into bundled contracts, what was the total spend with small businesses, and we do have all those metrics, and by all those measures, we are doing very well, and we're nowhere near the kinds of concerns they had, where they're, you know, half of all of their contracts or 50%, you know, were going to strategic sourcing. We have less than 10% of all of our contracts going to any kind of mandatory contract.
And just speaking of Mr. Johnson for a moment, he also provided us with a report. I don't know if you had a chance to see this contract bundling report from October 2002.
No, sir, I have not.
But it did indicate, as he did in his testimony, that for every $100 awarded on a bundled contract, there is a $33 decrease to small businesses. Also, for every 100 bundled contracts, 106 individual contracts are no longer available to small business. Now, the federal government's a somewhat different animal. I think we'll all acknowledge that. But the trends make one wonder.
I agree with the trend, sir, and I, as in my opening statement mentioned, is to indicate there is a balance here. And as we look at the numbers and we look at the performance over time, we believe we're striking an appropriate balance. We are saving dollars on the one hand, but on the other hand, it's tilted towards small business, because we see a lot higher success rates in our achievement on the small business side, whereas we have been asked by the state auditor, at least recommended, to perform more strategic sourcing, which we have indicated that we would do in compliance with the request. So, you know, we're always going to be in the middle of that balancing test.
I'm not sure if the auditor's request was more strategic as opposed to doing it when it was appropriate with data that would support it.
I will not put words in their mouth. I'm just referring to the reports.
Okay. And with regard to also looking at the same chart of the small business DVBE spending, that's self-reported by departments?
Yes, sir, it is.
And that is without any great degree of enforcement from what we hear on whether those businesses in many instances should actually qualify for being categorized as small businesses or DVBEs?
I haven't heard.
Or constitute pass-throughs?
Yeah, I haven't heard anyone question the certification, which is a separate issue from the commercial useful function. So the certification as a small business is a pretty factual kind of a question. It's a revenue threshold and a number of employees.
Well, it's self-report, though.
Yes, sir, it is. And but in terms of the CUF question, I think that is an area that we could go into in more detail if you'd like. But the way that CUF is assessed today is that on the contracts that we administer, we evaluate CUF at the time of award. We have a form that we've included in the exhibits that shows the process that we go through. It's Exhibit 6, I believe. And then we have started a process of reassessing CUF 6 months into the contract and then annually every year thereafter. And that was, again, some of the testimony you heard from Mr. Simpson. Because we recognize that we, again, through the input of the auditor, that we can take a larger role. While not required to by law, we think it's prudent. We think it's a good approach to ensure taxpayers' money is well spent on preferences for small businesses and DVBs.
The testimony included comments related to CUF and pass-through circumstances. We have 23,000 certified small businesses or DVBEs, mm-hmm. by your accounting. The vice chair asked about whether penalties had been invoked when we had the Caltrans staff person, yes. testifying. What has the Department of General Services done with, if anything, with respect to enforcing CUF? And what kinds of penalties have been imposed, if any, and how many times?
Sure. I'll point you to Exhibit, get my number right, Exhibit 7 lists a table of denied certifications over the last, I believe, 10 years. And there was some earlier testimony around the word suspension. Just to clarify, suspension pertains only to a contract. So once a contractor starts on a contract, if they fail to perform, they can be suspended. That is very rare. The state's legislation in that area is actually quite weak by comparison to other states. However, as it pertains to their certification, the department has taken a lot of steps to deny and revoke certification for suppliers that are not meeting their requirements. And so you see that on average between 2001 and 2008, the department has suspended or has revoked or denied certification for between 1,200 and 2,000 small business and DVBs per year. And so that is our response to, you know, how do we ensure that we don't have a bunch of pass-throughs just sitting in the system. And again, it's about 10%. It's very close to the number that Mr. Bercher cited in his testimony about the number of small businesses that are no longer certified. It's because there's, again, about a 10% rate that get decertified on an annual basis.
Is there some number of the denials that are businesses or individuals who just simply don't reapply or don't,
absolutely.
Or don't recertify?
Yes, and we do not have the breakdown of what the reason is for no longer applying, but it could very well be that they go out of business, or it could be that they've been told you're not meeting CUF and you're not going to be able to compete anymore, so therefore they no longer seek certification.
So do you, if this doesn't reflect it, do you have records of how many of those denials that consisted of a letter or some form of notification being issued that you are denied?
No, we do not track that on a standalone basis. I did read in some of the previous information that was supplied that there was a statement that Caltrans had referred something like 20 cases a year to the department, and I won't put words in the Caltrans mouth, but I did speak to Ms. Fonseca about that number. She said no, it's been 20 over all the years that we've worked. So I want to make sure there's no misconception about the number of complaints that we receive. If we were receiving, you know, 100 or more complaints a year, we'd probably track them on an individual basis. But we receive so few complaints from departments that it has been worth tracking.
And the I'm sorry, I missed the last column, just looking at the that second chart on the page behind Exhibit 7 of DVBE Rev, that's revocations?
Yes, revocations.
Over 8 years or so, that's roughly 150.
Well, for each year, yes. Over that time, yes.
I'm sorry?
That's correct.
Okay, including those who've just walked away or not pursued it.
Well, these are specifically denials and revocations. So my earlier testimony may have been accurate. Let me get a clarification of whether we know for sure that these were actual denials and revocations or just failure to seek recertification. So.
Okay.
Other question? Oh, Ms. Grove, you have a question. Either one, whoever wants.
Okay. I'd like to understand more of the PIA contracts, because I actually do believe we need to, if we can give our inmates skills when they get out, that the recidivism rate should be lower, and it, you know, it certainly makes sense. But there were comments earlier talking about how some of these contracts were $500,000 higher or whatever, and I'm just trying to understand, and this may be not your purview, and it may be, I actually, when I look at the recommendations, would probably rather have an audit of this than the other, since we had the other audit in 2010. But I'm trying to understand how, if with prison labor, how if we're paying, what is it, 50 cents an hour or whatever we're paying, how we can end up with these contracts being so much higher. And are we truly paying the cost? Because I think we should be paying the cost of the product, or are we paying an amount that's substantially higher and then padding the budget of that area in a different way instead of handling it through the budgeting process?
In general, DGS has not weighed in on prison industry authority, their authority to assert a category that they're going to go into business over. We do have a waiver process in our contracts that if we have a competing contract, we will include language that says that you have to go to the PIA first to get a waiver before you can use our contract. But we don't get into the business of telling them, at least we haven't, to my knowledge, of saying you can't be in this category or that your pricing is too high.
Yeah, you see, and I don't have a problem with the priority if the prices are honest prices and sure, based on the actual cost, and we're, because the training and the other benefits we get, I think, are significant. But if PIA is not under you, and my understanding is it's not under corrections, how are we doing the proper audits to make sure that the costs are real, are accurate, are transparent, and like I said, we're not just padding budgets somewhere? I obviously, since it's under you, don't have a comment for that. But I actually have another commitment, Mr. Chair. But like I said, when I take a look at the three recommendations, which I don't know how much, if we did a JLAC audit in 2010, I don't know how much more information we're going to get. But that is one area where I'd be very interested in having additional information and potentially having us request an audit.
Okay. And thank you, Ms. Buchanan. I think what we might do is take, we had some draft recommendations. I think we might take into account the testimony we've heard this morning and work on those and come back with our next hearing to look at adoption. So thank you for that comment. Ms. Grove.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm glad this chart stayed up because it's the one I have the questions on. In 07 and 08, there was a significant higher dollar amount of total contract award on this graph that it says. The dark blue is the total contract award, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And then in 08 and 09, there was a reduction in the total contract award, but there was an increase in the small business or the veteran benefit business. So is that accurate that you actually issued a lower amount of contract dollars but increased your business with small business or disabled veterans businesses?
It's accurate that the percentage of contracting with small businesses and DVBs went up.
Correct.
It went up from 23.8 to 26.18%.
But the total dollars that you guys, now what was the difference? Is that just more revenue? You guys are saving the state money, you're trying to reduce cost, or was there just not work to be done?
The governor in 2000, partway through that fiscal year, issued an executive order limiting contracting and restricting agencies' abilities to enter into contracts without certain oversight. And as a result, at least partially attributable to that, the total spend went down by, it looks like, about $2 billion across the state.
I just want to make sure I understand the information that you gave us so I can, because I know we're going to be making decisions later on some request. So you guys issued roughly $2 billion less in actual dollars, but you increase the volume of dollars for small business and disabled veterans businesses?
Well, it was a slight decrease. It went from $2.6 billion to about $2.4 billion in the SBDVB contracting as a dollar amount, but the percentage increased.
But the percentage went up.
Because the denominator went down so much.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Mr. Curry? Okay. All right. I think the Mr. Parentino, do you have it? All right.
The chair's recommendation.
Okay. Thank you, all three.
Thank you as well.
For being here this morning. And as I mentioned a moment ago, we do have some draft recommendations, but I think in light of the hour and the attendance, rather than try to get people back, I think we should take into account the testimony we've heard this morning and consult on those with the vice chairman and see if we can
see what action we take at the next meeting.
Develop them for the next meeting. So if there are members of the public who wish to speak, we'll hear that briefly at this point. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much. And it looks like I'm going to be the only one, so I will, but I will make it brief. I'm Lori Cameron. I represent the Coalition of Small and Disabled Veteran Businesses, about 17,000 certified small businesses and disabled veteran businesses who work and contract with the state of California. A couple of things I wanted to just bring up very briefly, and with the hope that you would decide to meet again and that maybe you would look at some other issues, because you have had to look at a lot of issues, CUF, the off-ramp, et cetera, in a short amount of time. But one of the things that Assemblymember Buchanan brought up is the PIA, Prison Industry Authority. And currently, right now, the state is a captive audience. They have to purchase from the PIA at prices that are inflated, considerably higher than what you would be able to purchase if you were buying from a small business. So we would like to see the opportunity for small businesses to compete with PIA. There's some things that small businesses can't come in lower. There are other things that the state's overpaying, and that if you could provide more contracts for the small businesses, you'd be providing more jobs for those prisoners, ex-offenders who are coming out of the prison system. Second thing is the off-ramp. You've heard discussions on that, and that may work for some industries, such as the office supplies, et cetera. It's detrimental and is very harmful to those who are in the food industry. The off-ramp, the small business secures the loan, hires the employees, first of all, obviously awarded the contract, secures the loan, pays their workers' comp and everything else, and then all of a sudden another small business or a pass-through can come through and circumvent their contract. So all of a sudden they've got the product, but the state doesn't want to buy from them. So that's a key issue. On the unbundling, very briefly, there are a couple of contracts that we think could be unbundled, and they're very large. The miscellaneous food contract, this contract formerly was a contract that was broken up into a lot of different contracts that did go to small businesses, and that's now been put into one big contract so that small businesses can't bid on the big contract. We'd like to see that broken up to, maybe a dozen contracts, put some more small businesses into business. And these are large food items. The second one, which is a very big contract that you'll probably hear about, is they call it the MRO, and we won't be using acronyms, but it's the maintenance repair order or something, maintenance repair, but it's, I think the company is an out-of-state company. If I'm wrong, it's still a large company. It's a contract that goes, that has over 100 items, paper towels, toilet papers, flashlights, lampshades, you name it. It could be opened up and spread out to small businesses, and we'd see a lot more dollars trickling into the local economies if those contracts were open. And I think that was it. I think I got everything. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Cameron, for those comments. Any other member of the public who wishes to testify? All right. I think we have heard some very helpful and useful testimony this morning. I think that from the chair's point of view, that we would certainly encourage the department to work closely with the auditor to try to get some certainty to this, because there seems to be a lot of numbers, but still a lot of uncertainty and speculation. To the extent that we're using this approach, we want to make sure, as we've said all along, that it truly benefits the state and does so without unduly harming small business and disabled veterans. So we'll take into account the testimony
consider what action might be appropriate for this committee to take and revisit that subject at our next hearing. So with that, thank you all who've been here, and we are adjourned.